distinguished guests, dear friends, ladies and gentlemen. First, I thank Vice President Vincent Siu for your kind words and your very warm recollection of our more than 30 years of friendship. I'm particularly honored by the presence of President Ma, whom I had the pleasure and honor of hosting to dinner in my home and at a bak kut teh stall in Singapore, which unfortunately closed down at the end of July. And in that bak kut teh stall are pictures of me with President Ma. And I was very nostalgic, so I took pictures of myself against that picture, knowing that the stall will be closed. I'm delighted to be here today, and I want to thank Dr. Kwan Shih Tsung Mao for arranging this visit for me to Taiwan. I'm so happy to be back. I want to thank the organizations, the university, and other and the foundations, of course, for sponsoring this organization and arranging, making all the fine arrangements. I first came to Taiwan in 1976. I had just graduated in England, gone over to the US to train in the US Army for 3 months as a signals officer. Then I went to Hawaii. I decided I wanted to visit Taiwan. On our passports, we were not allowed to visit Taiwan or Talu. But the Taiwan consulate in Honolulu made special arrangements to put the visa on a separate piece of paper. So I applied for the visa, and my arrival in Taiwan was a little uncomfortable because the customs were very strict. There was a little box which I used to keep little things. The customs official took it up and said, "This is from China," and threw it away. I was quite stunned. And in fact, in my suitcase, I had the collected works in 4 volumes of Mao Zedong, with the covers torn out because I was afraid of Singapore authorities. Then I thought, wow, if the Taiwan customs official had seen the works of Mao Zedong, I would have been, I think, caught up for a friendly conversation. So I was a little rattled my first visit. You see, my mother was from Shantou. She married my father when she was at the age of 19. And she had always told me that Taiwan is a part of China. And the only reason why it was separate was because of the Americans. Now, she was not pro-communist because the family suffered a lot because of the overseas Chinese connection. But she was always loyal to the idea of China till she died. So I came with a certain baggage in my mind. And I had a relative here who invited me to dinner. They were high KMT officials. I don't know who they were. And I didn't quite like the way when the waitress spilled something on one of them, their reaction. I said, "Oh, this is a little too strong." I think at that time, Taiwan society was quite repressive. It was the first stage of economic development. And many Westerners considered Lee Kuan Yew also to be quite repressive. And looking back, yes, he was. Because without law and order, you can't create the conditions for development. Then I went back to work in the army. A year later, I came back to Taiwan for training in Hengchun. And it was incredible because Taiwan gave us such incredible facilities. We wore ROC uniform without the ranks, without the badges. The entire camp was vacated for our use. And Sing Quang Poo being trained all over Taiwan, conducting live firing. I learned that Lee Kuan Yew had a very close relationship with Jiang Jingguo. Jiang Jingguo treated him as a younger brother, 13 years older than Lee Kuan Yew. And I think, without saying so, wanted a Chinese majority Singapore to succeed. And to succeed, we had to pick up the gun. To pick up the gun, we had to learn how to use the gun, we needed training areas. And Taiwan, in those critical years, when we were most vulnerable, provided us the training areas. Which is why Singapore will never forget Taiwan's contribution to our independence. I remember one year at the Chinese New Year gathering for grassroots leaders in Singapore. There was no media publicity. And Lee Kuan Yew gave a speech. He said, "The mainland considers me an old friend, but Taiwan is an older friend." But in his interaction with Jiang Jingguo, he made clear that one day Singapore will recognize Beijing. And when that day happened, the ROC flag, the ROC crest in Singapore would have to come down. So when we established diplomatic relations with China in 1990, there was no issue because there was never any false expectation. Jiang Jingguo was getting old, and Lee Kuan Yew was briefing us in cabinet that he was already going to dismantle martial law, Taiwan would enter a new phase of development, and Singapore ministers would have to know new Taiwan leaders. I also remember him saying that regardless whether or not we had diplomatic relations with China, he would have to come to Taiwan for Jiang Jingguo's funeral. Which he did. I was in the army, then was posted to the Air Force. My first boss in the Air Force was an ROC Air Force pilot, Fu Chun Xian. I think he was a one-star general in Taiwan, but because in Singapore we all had low ranks, so he became a lieutenant colonel. A wonderful person from Shantung. And I learned so much from him, not only about the Air Force, but also about China and Taiwan society. He was famous because he was the first ROC fighter pilot to shoot down a mainland MIG with a sidewinder. So I think the mainland had his records. So one day he told me, "I'm going to China, to Dalu, to Shantung." Singapore at that time had no diplomatic relations with China, but they had an office in Singapore. So he went to the office in Singapore with his Singapore passport and asked for a permit to enter China, feeling a little anxious. But in fact, the Chinese knew his complete background and said, "Look, is there anything we can do for you when you visit your Lao Jia Xiang?" He said, "Oh, no need, not necessary." And he had a very good visit, and after that he went back repeatedly. And a few years ago, he died in Los Angeles. And I sent online my message of condolence to my old boss. Then I became Director of Joint Operations and Planning. And then I came to Taiwan as a senior officer, and I met many Taiwan generals and drank a lot of gao liang jiu. And I learned one thing, that the higher the rank, the better the quality. And the less a hangover. But it was for me a glimpse into an old China, where many of the officers were from Shantung and very warm people. When I became a minister, Lee Kuan Yew taught me many things. And in many cabinet meetings, he talked about Taiwan. In 1989, the first APEC meeting was held in Canberra. It was at the same time as the Berlin Wall came down. And at that first meeting, we were talking about the three Chinas, meaning the mainland, Hong Kong, and Taiwan, and how to bring them in. The following year, we had a meeting in Singapore, and we kind of agreed that APEC should be an economic ministers meeting. And when the leaders met, it was not a summit, but a meeting of economic leaders. Then the following year in Seoul, where I met Vice President Vincent Siu for the first time, an agreement was struck that no flags, no political names at APEC, Taiwan and Hong Kong will be represented by one minister. And then the following year, in 1992, in Bangkok, Taiwan was represented by Vice President Vincent Siu, China by Li Lanxing, Hong Kong by Brian Chow, Chow Tak Hei. And at lunch, we gathered, it was a buffet, together to eat. I felt that I was like a relative joining a family lunch. I was so emotional. I can't remember what we discussed, but I remember the significance of that gathering where the discussion was intimate, friendly, casual. A period in history has passed. 1992, 九二共识. 1993, the Wang Ku talks in Singapore. Now, Singapore was not involved in mediating the two sides. Singapore only provided tables and chairs. But why did they choose Singapore? Because they felt that Singapore was friendly, meant both sides well. And I was involved in preserving Wang Qingyuan, which Sung Chong San Xiansheng had stayed in many times, where some of the uprisings against the Qing dynasty was organized. So I said it must become a national monument for us. And we Lee Kuan Yew opened it as a Sung Chong San Nanyang Jinianguan. And Feng Chong Han, the director, there was a big boulder cleft in two. On one side, the calligraphy by Gu Zhenfu, the other side, the calligraphy by Wang Taohan, expressing the hope that one day the boulder will come together again. And leaders of both Taiwan and the mainland have been visiting Wang Qingyuan, not only as a Jinianguan, but almost as a shrine to a common origin and the hope for a common future. When I became Trade Minister in 1999, negotiations were already going on for both the mainland and Taiwan to join the WTO as customs territories. But at the end of 2000, big change in Taiwan because of the elections. I was in Taipei's home, watching the election results. Everybody was somber because the KMT had lost. And I still remember watching live on television, very unhappy people around the presidential palace. Li Denghui Zongtong did not speak. And in the end, it was President Ma who came out to comfort the crowd and to tell them, please go home and take a rest. I was so, no, President Ma, that night when I watched you, I was so moved. I said, leadership is expressed in such moments, not when times are calm and things are easy. And at that critical moment, which you could not have planned for, you did the right thing and you were able to maintain the peace in Taipei. But in Taiwan, there was a seismic shift, especially among young people, because memories of the old KMT, old bitter feelings have been bottled up. And the process of democratization had still to fully run its course. Taiwan society had changed. And this change, in fact, began during the time of President Lee Teng Hui. I remember in 1994, when Shiba Ryutaro interviewed Lee Teng Hui, and he talked about taking the Taiwanese people out from Egypt. There was consternation among the KMT old guards. I remember General Hao Bo-chun. He couldn't accept it. Now, he was a wonderful person. I played golf with him. I think it was at Tashi golf course. It was lightning and thunder. I thought he would stop the game. He said, no, this is at wartime. I continued playing. He had short, accurate shots. You know, my golf was much poorer than his. But I was watching him. I said, a veteran of the Civil War, nerves of steel. Nothing rattled him. But when President Lee made those remarks, inside, he was angry. But something had already shifted in Taiwan society. When Lee Kuan Yew heard of the interview, he was very troubled. And after that, in his subsequent meetings with President Lee Teng Hui, he was very cautious. I was with him when he met Lee Teng Hui in Tashi, because it was not convenient to go into Taipei City, so we were outside. He was very careful now, being very polite, but trying to understand what was the shift in Taiwan society. In 1999, I called on President Lee. He gave me a copy of his book, Taiwan's Road to Democracy. We were talking about Yasukuni, and I expressed misgivings about Japanese leaders visiting Yasukuni. His response surprised me. He said, what is wrong with them? They are just honoring their war dead. I did not realize at that time that his own brother was being remembered in Yasukuni. But Singapore could not take sides. And our gratitude to Taiwan transcended Taiwan's domestic politics. And today, I speak as an individual, not for the government, because I have my own views, which overlap with the government's, but I do not speak for the government. And I hope you respect this position that I take. Chen Shui-bian had taken over, but I knew Taiwan was going to join the WTO. And Singapore had embarked on FTAs. So in June 2001, after the Hainan spy plane incident, when US-China relations were very tense, the trade ministers met in Shanghai. So I met both Shi Guangsheng, the Chinese Commerce Minister, and I met Lin Xingyi, Taiwan's trade minister. I told Minister Lin, I said, why don't Singapore and Taiwan, under the WTO rules, have a free trade agreement? So I drafted three sentences for him. I said, we launch under the dragon's nose in Shanghai. He thanked me. He said, I got to check back with Taipei. Taipei came back with two pages, all political statements. I said, no, we cannot do this. The following year, I tried again. Again, it could not be done. Then China found out. And one day after a meeting, I was with Shi Guangsheng. He pulled me aside. He said, you cannot launch negotiations with Taiwan. If you do that, we will not launch negotiations with Singapore for a free trade agreement. And a Western reporter heard this. He said, can you give your reply? I have to report that Taiwan, China's minister had threatened the Singapore minister. I said, no, it's a private conversation. I do not comment on private conversation. But Singapore and Taiwan, as customs territories, have a right to have a free trade agreement. But in practice, we stopped. Because a free trade agreement with China was much more valuable to Singapore. In any case, Taiwan itself was reluctant to have one which is apolitical. It was many years later when it was China which told Singapore, negotiate a free trade agreement with Taiwan. And that was because it was under President Ma's time, China itself had a free trade agreement with Taiwan, and after that, Singapore had a free trade agreement with Taiwan. So in different ways, Singapore somehow got caught up. When I became foreign minister in 2004, I could no longer come to Taiwan because that's part of the discipline of our One China policy. But in 2004, when I became foreign minister, we had a big problem with the mainland. Because a month earlier, Vice Deputy Prime Minister Lee Hsien Loong had visited Taiwan. The agreement was no publicity. But in Taiwan, all the newspapers and television stations gave it headline news. And this went on for 2-3 days. So Ta Lu was very angry because their position was being undermined by Singapore. And suddenly our relations with Ta Lu went below 0 degrees. And this was the first issue I had to deal with as foreign minister. It was a very bad time for me because my youngest son had just had a second relapse of his leukemia and needed a bone marrow transplant. And even with a bone marrow transplant, the chance of him surviving would be less than 10%. So among his siblings, there was no match. In Singapore, there was no match. In Hong Kong, there was no match. Finally, through Ciji Foundation in Taiwan, we found a match. And that saved him. They were in Memphis for the bone marrow transplant. I went to give my speech at the UN General Assembly where I reaffirmed Singapore's One China policy because I was going to meet Li Zhaoxing, the Chinese foreign minister, in New York. Taiwan diplomats in New York were very unhappy with me. They felt that I should not have said that at the UN General Assembly. And I was severely criticized by Taiwan. My reply was, I'm very sad about this. Our people-to-people relations remain very good. I could not say at the time that it was Taiwan which was helping to save my son, because the bone marrow, which was taken from the donor, had to clear customs without being x-rayed. And Taiwan's foreign ministry facilitated everything. So this time when I came, the first thing we did when we landed was to go to Hualien to call on Zheng Yan Shangren. And she was so happy to see my son Freddie, who's here today, who's now 29 years old and graduated as a doctor. They were so happy to see that the efforts they put in have borne one fruit in our family. And we remain eternally grateful to Ciji. And I always ask myself, why is Ciji a Taiwan phenomenon? We don't find Ciji in other countries. Of course, in Taiwan, there are other Buddhist organizations like Fa Gu, Fo Guan, and Zhongtai, but my familiarity is with Ciji. And what they do, not just for Taiwanese people, but for the people of the world, is remarkable. It's remarkable. So when I see the division in Taiwan today between blue and green, it is very painful to watch. In both the blue and green, we have Enren, we have people who have helped us, gone out of their way to save us. I cannot believe that Taiwanese are not Chinese. I mean, when I come to Taiwan, it reminds me so much of a China that has attenuated after 49, and therefore a China that is closer to the China that we know in Singapore that I saw in my own parents and relatives. This year, on the third day of the third month, I do Tai Chi. My Tai Chi master said, okay, everybody should now bai Xuan Di, the Wudang Tai Chi master who is our patron saint. And I remember one year we went to Yilan, we went to Sanqing Miao to practice Tai Chi. And that's the mother temple of all the Taoist temples in Taiwan. And at the level of ordinary people, whether it is Chinese New Year, the 7 months, Zhongqiu, the same celebrations. The division is at a political level, not at the cultural or at the civilizational level. Yesterday, I had a meeting with young employees of MyCon, and one of them said, I'm Taiwanese. I don't feel I'm Chinese. I can understand why he said that, because he was expressing a political feeling. To be Chinese is not to be a citizen of the PRC. But when they say they cannot accept being called a Chinese because they see in it a political danger, they may be absorbed into the mainland. That I can understand. And if I were a young Taiwanese, I may feel the same way. Lee Kuan Yew once said, between China and Taiwan, we say Qianli. It's like a long journey. The Americans do not want the two to ever come together, to continue on parallel paths forever. That would be the American preferred position, because then Taiwan will never be an unsinkable aircraft carrier for the mainland. Then Taiwan is an additional piece they can use in a great game. That is American position. Then for the mainland, Lee Kuan Yew said, of course they want the two paths to come together, today if possible. Then they said, for Singapore, we hope they will come together, but not too soon. But not too soon, because both are unrun to Singapore. So it's not bad if we continue to nourish old friendships, old relationships. The status quo, which everyone likes to say is the preferred position, is not a permanent solution. It is only a temporary solution, because the question of Taiwan is ultimately a question of US-China relations. The US accepted that Taiwan is part of China. This was in the Cairo Declaration. This was affirmed in the Potsdam Proclamation. This was the position the US took when during the Civil War. So the US helped the Taiwanese Navy occupy islands in the South China Sea. And it's not a surprise that Taiwan's position on Diaoyi, on the South China Sea Islands, are the same as the mainland. And I remember having conversations with President Ma about the Diaoyi Island, for whom this is an issue of principle. And when I called on President Ma before he stepped down, it was in 2016, April, I think, you had just gone to Taiping Town. And you told me about how the island produced 20 tons of fresh water a day. And you brought back drums of fresh water from Taiping Town, as if they are holy water from a Catholic shrine. And I told Singapore friends that if I asked a bottle from you, you would have given it to me at that time. And this was the American position. But when the mainland became a problem, a challenge to America, the Korean War, the Seventh Fleet came in, it was in American interest to keep the two apart. Kissinger, when he negotiated normalization of relations with China, in his meetings with Zhou Enlai and Mao Zedong, said, again and again, the conversation came back to Taiwan. That on this issue, the Chinese showed no flexibility. It's bedrock. It is not a card which America can play against China because it would lead to a rupture and maybe even to war. And in recent years, relations have become quite bad. Both sides think of war scenarios. What happens if there is war? What will each side do? If China were to forcibly take over Taiwan, what would the US do? These are scenarios which the Indo-Pacific Command, as a matter of professionalism, have to think through and exercise. RAN has also done such exercises. I think the US have come to the conclusion that if it's a conventional war, there is no certainty of winning. In fact, there's a good chance that they may lose. Because China now has hypersonic missiles. We can travel maybe 2,000-3,000 kilometers to hit US aircraft carriers, which means that aircraft carriers have to stay away and cannot intervene in Taiwan. So for the Americans, if they want to deter China, they must be able to threaten China with nuclear weapons, tactical, and maybe up the scale if necessary. And you can be sure that on both sides, in dark rooms, there are strategic thinkers who work through the scenarios. China knows that the US wants to deny it a counter-strike capability. They put their missiles now on high-speed train. It's about the same length. And China has lots of tunnels, so they can hide the missiles in the tunnels. But today with satellites, you can monitor every railroad, every fast train, the entrance and the exit to every tunnel. So China is not sure that its land-based ICBMs can hit back. So they know they need submarines. And the only sea which is deep enough is the South China Sea. And in ASEAN, we don't want to get involved in this. We have our claims, we have our economic interests, but we are not involved in nuclear warfare. And the reason for AUKUS is to add maybe another 8 Australian attack submarines so that every strategic submarine in the PLA Navy can be tracked and hunted down. Now this is, to me, madness, you know. They are thinking of the possibility of a nuclear exchange. But when I was in the military, this is my job. I got to think through all this. So China knows that it must have an assured counter-strike capability because the US wants to deny China a counter-strike capability. So from a few hundred warheads, is going to increase it to maybe 1,000-2,000, I don't know. And we read that in Xinjiang, they are building many silos. So maybe for every ICBM, they may have two empty silos, like an MX game, you know, so that it's hard for the Americans to destroy everything in the first try. Now, if I were Taiwanese, think about this. In 10 years' time, China will have almost a certain counter-strike capability against the US. So at a conventional level, they may not prevail. At the nuclear level, the risks are too high. At that point, the pressure on Taiwan, political, military, economic pressure, is bound to grow. So therefore, the status quo is a ticking bomb. To say, keep the status quo, is to say, let it tick. It will not tick forever. In 10 years' time, you'll be ticking much faster. Lee Kuan Yew had always taken the position that it is better for Taiwan to negotiate with the mainland earlier rather than later. Because the longer you wait, the weaker your relative negotiating position. But of course, there are Taiwanese who believe that maybe if you wait long enough, something will happen to the mainland. Some big struggle in the Communist Party, a new civil war, and then a path for Taiwan to escape and become independent. You know, Li Teng Hui said, take Taiwan out from Egypt. Well, maybe one day the Red Sea will open. But you cannot base policy on such a possibility. It's too dangerous. It may happen, but it's not a high chance. And policy cannot be based on that. So, from me watching this, with some emotion, but not with the emotion of a Taiwanese, I say, no, better to negotiate now. Which was why we had the 九二共识, which was why we had the free trade agreement under President Ma. And there's this view that President Xi Jinping can't wait to invade Taiwan for his legacy. This, to me, is not consistent with what he did in 2015. When in Singapore, President Xi met President Ma over dinner at the Shangri-La. At that time, I was with the Kwok group. So I asked one of the Kwoks, I said, who paid for the bill? She told me 50-50, down to the last cent. I remember President Ma brought Jingmen Gao Liang, and President Xi, of course, brought the Guizhou Mao Tai. You know. I think both are equally good, equally strong. And the words spoken that evening was so moving. I mean, I'm not from Taiwan, not from mainland, but I'm ethnic Chinese. And I was really moved by those words. And I remember talking to Robert Kwok about it. He too was moved by those words and moved by the symbolism of that meeting where both sides transcended politics. They address each other as Sensheng. Not Mr. Mr. is the low-level way of addressing. Sensheng is the highest level of addressing each other. In other words, the key is to go up, not to go down. But at that time, President Mao is already stepping down. And everyone knew that it was likely that Tsai Ing-wen would become president. With Vice President Winston Hsu's help, I called on Tsai Ing-wen after she was elected, before she was sworn in. She said that China did not have a positive attitude. I told her, I said, in Singapore, Xi Jinping had opened the road for you. She did not respond to me, but she knew what I meant. But I knew that she could not take that road, because that road requires her to accept a one China consensus, and she could not take it. In the DPP constitution, it says, our goal is an independent republic of Taiwan. Even though both Chen Shui-bian and Tsai Ing-wen swore on the Mingguo Xianfa of one China. So this is something which is very wrenching for green Taiwanese. They know that there is a road, but that road means that there could be a trap, because one China may mean one PRC, 一国两制. So they say no. The alternative is a dead end and tragedy, not just for Taiwan and the mainland, but I think for Singapore and for the entire region, for the world, if there's war between China and the US. This road is not a superhighway, but it's not a bad road. And one China, the PRC did not say one PRC policy, it says one China. It did not say when. It says 什么都可以谈. You can discuss everything. So when Tu Li Lun, whom I had dinner with last night, he was in America. He said there's no consensus on the one China consensus, on the 九二共识. He said, I was just using the words of Ku Zheng Fu. Ambiguity is a key to the future. I mean, in Tai Chi, I do Tai Chi for 15 years, and Tao Te Ching, the second line, Ming Ke Ming, Fei Chang Ming. If you define it too much, it disappears. So ambiguity is necessary. The mainland will accept some ambiguity. Taiwan should accept some ambiguity. The problem is the DPP constitution. Please excuse me if I speak out of turn, but this is my musing, my fantasizing. Maybe it is possible for the two sides to agree to some kind of a Chinese Commonwealth. Li Xiulian talked about it. Vice President Li Xiulian talked about it. I wrote it in English. So I was told in Taiwan, translated as Bang Lian, not Lian Ban. Because Lian Ban has got other connotations. There are too many other references. There are precedents. In Iceland, the Icelandic people met every year in the Rift Valley. They make laws. They talk about trade disputes. They pass judgments. They punish. Then they went back to their separate valleys. There was no executive, no common executive. It was called the Althingi. It was Europe's earliest modern democracy. Then if you study Switzerland, the cantons came together to form the Helvetian Confederation. Again, they had no executive, but they met to discuss common problems. So when we talk about one China, maybe we can talk about the one China Commonwealth, where the two sides talk about trade, cooperation, problems, agree on certain principles, without the need for a common executive. Can the mainland accept that? I think they can. Why do I say that? If you look at Macau in the 16th century was given to the Portuguese. It was not taken from the Ming Dynasty because China wanted the Portuguese to have their own area and don't trouble me. And the Portuguese understood that. Never be a problem to China. The Qing Dynasty renewed it. But in the 19th century, when China was being ravaged by the imperial powers, Portugal decided to take Macau. But they had a revolution in 1973. And they said, we want to return Macau immediately to China. What did China say? China said, no. We have to settle Hong Kong first. Please stay. So it was only in 1999 that Macau returned to the mainland. And even to today, there is no practical change in how Macau is run or the mechanist way of life. We do not know what China will be in 20 years' time. China today is very different from China 20 years ago. Unrecognizable of what China was 40 years ago. So 20 years from now, 40 years from now, what will China be? What will Taiwan be? So in my free moments, it's something I play in my mind, the possibility of a Chinese Commonwealth where they come together, where you maintain your links with America, but not to an extent which threatens China, where you maintain your links to Singapore and other countries, where Xin Kuang Pu Ping can still be in Taiwan with no problem. But as I said, the problem is the party constitution of the DPP. Maybe it's possible. You can't change the constitution. It's too difficult. But maybe it is possible for the various political parties in Taiwan to add a preamble of what One China means to Taiwan. What does it mean to Taiwan? So you make your position clearer, and leave the mainland to do what it wants. But you make your position clearer. And this is to the advantage of Taiwanese people. Because if you are divided in Taiwan, your position is weakened. But if among the political parties there is broad consensus about the 九二共识, that it means for a prolonged period a commonwealth, not a PRC, not an ROC, maybe by that time it's just called China, and you can apply this in Olympic Games and other international organizations, that there is a way forward. And I believe a little clarification on the Taiwan side will enable Taiwan to go back on the road, which was opened by Xi Jinping and Ma Ying-jeou in Singapore in 2015. It will only work if Taiwan is valuable to the mainland. What makes Taiwan valuable to the mainland? Why do Singaporeans and Hong Kongers and others like to visit Taiwan? It's a great physical beauty. The people are very cultured. The food is excellent. There is a common courtesy among young and old, even to foreigners. And there is a cosmopolitan feel to it. You're an American, a Japanese, you come to Taiwan, you feel, yes, you're comfortable. You may have some difficulty here and there, but basically it's an international society. You know, because Taiwan politically is in a very constrained position and getting more and more constricted, there is almost a psychological sublimation of Taiwan, which has enabled it to excel in other areas. I talk about Cixi. I think Cixi and the other Buddhist organizations are Taiwan's response to what it could not express at a political level. And so it finds expression at a higher spiritual level by helping the world. And we ourselves are beneficiaries of this. China has not got a Cixi. Singapore has not got a Cixi. No other country has a Cixi. Why? Is it in Chinese history? Not really. But it's in Taiwan's history because of your political position. The other area where you have excelled is in semiconductors. You know, Vivek Ramaswamy, the Republican candidate, very clever, very eloquent. He said, no, we must get TSMC to go to the US. Then in 10 years, we don't need Taiwan anymore. We can give it to China. He doesn't understand that TSMC is not just factories and individuals. TSMC grew up in an ecosystem, in a Taiwanese ecosystem. It cannot be replicated in America. It cannot be fully replicated in China. It cannot be replicated in Singapore. Why is that? To begin with, you are a very educated population, smart people. I'm so honored that the K.T. Lee Foundation, K.T. Lee was the father of all this, laid the foundation. You couldn't have done it without your mainland connection. You couldn't have done it without the American connection, without the Japanese connection. All these are layers in Taiwan society, which makes you unique, special, and valuable to the mainland. Convergence as equals will only work if Taiwan continues to be of value to the mainland. This is how Singapore conducts relations with China. There was a period when China needed Singapore for many things. But we know that for those things, China no longer needs Singapore. So we must continue to have things which China wants, which it cannot develop for itself in Singapore, for us to be of continuing interest to China. And indeed, we do this for the entire world, that we only prosper by being of value, by contributing to the well-being of others. And this Taiwan must continue to do, and can continue to do, provided your young people, your smart people, remain in Taiwan, that even when they walk overseas, in their hearts, they are still Taiwanese. That is the key. My son was saved in St. Jude Hospital by a doctor, Pei Zheng Kang, Pei, famous family during Tang Dynasty, 上面, Fei Zhe, 下面, Yi Zhe. Ifu de Yi. He's Yong Zheng de Zheng, Kang Si de Kang. So it's a very weighty name. Jiang Su Ren, born, grew up in Hong Kong, Tai Da Asian. And he told me he's always grateful to Tai Da and to Taiwan for educating him. Then he went to America and became the number one doctor in the world for the treatment of childhood leukemia, bringing the cure rate from 40% to 94% with minimal morbidity. And when my family was in Taiwan, I was in Memphis, he got the Christian Taiwanese community in Memphis to help look after my family. So there's something special about Taiwan. But the key is, in Taiwan, there must be hope for the future. I asked the young people I met yesterday, in 20 years' time, when you are married with children, where do you want your children to be? What passports do you want them to hold? If all we can tell them is a status quo, they will leave. But if we can give them hope for the future, not only will Taiwanese stay in Taiwan and remain Taiwanese, others will want to live here. Thank you.
The first one is from Louis. Do you think that while the 1992 consensus may promote cross-strait communications, it will seriously undermine ROC's sovereignty?
This is the tail end of a long civil war. Yesterday, I was at the Grand Hotel. Xu Song Mao brought us there to see the old photographs. This was an epic drama, the fight between Mao Zedong and Jiang Zemin. They fought and met everywhere in China. And we have reached the end of the Civil War. It's peaceful. And we hope that that final chapter can be written peacefully. The key is US-China relations. Taiwan is only separate because of America. And for America, Taiwan is just a piece on the chessboard. We ask ourselves, the relative power of China and the US 10 years ago, of China and the US today, of China and the US 10 years from now, 20 years from now. There was a time when US GIs were in the streets of Taipei, not that long ago. The US will not be able to maintain the same relative position. And as China grows stronger, that final chapter will have to close.
And we have a second question from Thomas Hu. How should we promote the idea that PRC can be a loyal opposition in the US-led world order and Taiwan a loyal opposition in the Chinese-speaking world?
I find it a bit difficult to fit my thinking into those categories in the question. I don't think it's a good idea to talk about opposition. US-China relations are very important for the entire world. If there is a conflict between them, it will destroy the world. So all of us should be working towards harmony. And between the mainland and Taiwan, we should work towards harmony. Because without harmony, there's no hope for the future.
And next, we have a question from Edward Shao. And sorry, Edward, I translated your question for you. At a time when the world is following the footsteps of the United States and hyping up China's invasion of Taiwan, do you think China would rather adopt peaceful reunification in the future than use force to resolve the conflict?
No, China, of course, wants peaceful reunification. It wants Taiwan as an asset, as a precious heirloom with wonderful properties, wonderful value. That's what China would want. I was watching Da Qing Fu, the 72-part series about the Qing Dynasty and unification of China, and how Qin Shi Huang wanted the Jiu Ding, but it disappeared. He wanted to take it by force, so it disappeared. Taiwan, to me, is a precious thing. And it should take its rightful place. It should not disappear. It should not be damaged.
And next question is from Lawrence Chong. Do you think the one China One country, two systems formula is good for Taiwan? If so, do you think Taiwan will end up like Hong Kong by accepting this arrangement?
Oh, no. I mean, for Hong Kong, it is a return to the PRC, which is why in Taiwan, one country, two systems cannot be accepted, because underlying it is a presumption that it is one PRC, two systems. So this cannot be acceptable to the ROC. As I said, this is still part of the Civil War. So the ROC has its own history, its own beliefs, its own philosophy, its own claims. And in the end, you either have a hostile acquisition, which would be a disaster for everybody, or you have a peaceful merger of equals. And that, to me, is achievable, because both sides will benefit from it. And not just for Taiwanese. I think it's of great value to the mainland. I mean, you can't say it, but there's a lot that the mainland can learn from Taiwan. I mean, someone spoke about the healthcare system in Taiwan, about how people treat one another, about the respect for the environment. You know, the hills here are so wonderfully cladded. In agriculture, Taiwan has done so much. No, the mainland has since caught up. But you've maintained an organic way of life, which if you can replicate, let us say, 70 times on the mainland. Can you imagine what a remarkable place the mainland would be if, to varying degrees, they're all a little like Taiwan on the mainland? And I believe the mainlanders who come to Taiwan, they know this. Their political problems with Japan. Part of it is because of the period of Japanese rule. I mean, I see when I come here, I mean, I have no sympathies for what the Japanese did, you know, but regardless, as the British left things behind in Singapore, Japan has left things behind here, which has added to you. And the American influence in Taiwan is everywhere. You may not even be conscious, but it's added to you. But have you become non-Chinese? Of course not, because Chinese programming is profound, it's very deep. So you have become a hybrid, which is, in the Chinese garden, a very wonderful plant in that garden, and which I believe everyone in the garden would want to maintain and see thriving forever.
And next question is from Sam Hong. What is the nature of conflict between mainland China and Taiwan when Taiwan poses no threat to China at all?
No, China's hope, China's deep emotion is for reunification. And this is not just mainland Chinese. I would say that for my mother, I would say for me emotionally, it's important to see eventual reunification. Why? Because of the circumstances which separated Taiwan from the mainland. Jiahu Zhangzheng, the ravaging of the Chinese mainland, the humiliation of Chinese all over the world, not just on the mainland in Taiwan, but because they spat on China, they had no regard for it. Wu Shiying-tong, when despite being part of victorious powers, he had no claim to Shantung, to German possessions in Shantung. That created a political awakening throughout the Nanyang. And many events in the Nanyang could be traced back to Wu Shi, to the Xing Wenhua, Yingtong. So we are part of one larger civilization. So the idea of a Taiwan which is separate from mainland suggests that a historical problem has still not been resolved. But how it should be resolved is for creative minds on both sides to think through, respecting each other, respecting the history, seeing the common origins, and finding ways towards a common, prosperous future. And I was quite, I think 1996, I accompanied Li Guangyao to Ningpo, and they brought us to Fenghua to see Chiang Kai-shek's old hometown. And he reminded me of his residence here. There's a certain respect for Chiang Kai-shek as protagonist in a civil war. And in Chinese history, when they talk about previous dynasties, yeah, they're protagonists, but they're all treated with respect. They all have their strengths and weaknesses. A certain judgment is formed, and it enters the popular folklore. And one day, Taiwanese heroes, KMT heroes, will be part of the romances in China's history. That's why when President Ma Ying-jeou made his visit to Nanjing, Changsha, Wuhan recently, I must say, I was very moved, you know. I've been to all those places, visited the same shrines, the same tombs and so on, the same museums. I said, yes, it is a common history. And how can there not be a common future? There'll only be a separate future if America makes it a separate future. And I think America will find it increasingly difficult to keep Taiwan separate from China. And therefore, the best outcome is convergence and peaceful reunification not on the basis of the PRC or ROC, but on some future entity which we can call China, simply.
As we're running out of time, we will take one last question from our audience. This is from Sunny H. How can a Chinese Commonwealth be developed when there are two different ideologies, communism and democracy, on opposite sides?
The way is to transcend the politics. So when we talk about 瓷器, we don't talk about politics. When we talk about semiconductors, we don't talk about politics. I mean, it can be politicized, but we are talking about the level of science, of physics, of process engineering, of lithography, of quantum mechanics. In these areas, scientists on both sides will learn from each other and enjoy each other's company and friendship. So transcend it. So I'm proposing, there must be better ways. These are just my random thoughts. There must be ways to transcend the politics to achieve a higher unity, not by fighting to keep every last embassy or saying that, oh, I must be a member here or a member there. No, transcend it. And in transcending it, assert a moral quality which even the mainland will have to accept. But if it's just at the level of politics, Taiwan will be in a very weak position and will be in a weakening position.
All right, thank you, Mr. Yeo. And that concludes the first half of the forum. We will be taking a 20-minute tea break, and please come into this room for our panel discussion at 10:40.